Max when I was about 14, and I was at some local show, and I saw this little hedgehog looking thing run across the stage and do a stage dive, and I was like, wow, that kid looks awesome.
Oh, Max is a nutcase.
The most crazy, non-stop person that I've ever met.
I still think Max is a nutcase, to be honest.
Ever since then, I've kind of probably been best friends with Max.
I met Josh through our old local scene back in the day. Josh was definitely a character. There's something about him. He's very cheeky. You gotta love his cheeky laugh and his enthusiasm and things, and how he's very passionate about a lot of things, and he's very dedicated to a lot of stuff, I would say.
My circle of friends that I knew from when I was younger went to the school that Josh went to, so he'd always be at like house parties and stuff that my friend used to always host.
When I actually first met Josh, I was just like, Who's this guy 2 years younger than me doing something that I want to do in this band in my local hall? I was just like, why are you in a band? You're 2 years younger than me. I want to be in a band. Me, I'll slow it down because I know that you can't keep up. Oh, maybe I was wrong from the start. I might be proud, but at least I'm proud of something. You've taken pride in becoming a... So yeah, do come on to that.
Okay. Alright, from the top. Cool. I'll slow it down because I know that you can't keep up. Oh, maybe I was the one from the start. I might be proud, but at least I'm proud of something. You've taken pride in becoming a... When I first met Matt, he was like this little Bob Marley like reject. He had this stupidly long hair down to here. And I first met him in a shopping centre, and he was wearing an Incubus t-shirt, and I was just like, I didn't know him. I was like, oh, you like Incubus? He's like, yeah. I was like, Incubus is my favourite band. He's like, cool. I was like, sweet, I'll see you around, kind of thing. Like, so it was, that was the first thing I kind of got from Matt, was that he liked Incubus and Bob Marley, two things I liked, so I thought I'd probably get along with him.
One day, Josh was like, okay, cool, let's start this band up, let's go for it.
And so I was like, oh, I know just the person. So I called up Matt. I was like, Matt, we're going to start off a band that's going to be on Drive Thru Records one day. He's like, yeah, I'm in. I'm like, sweet. And then we had our first band practice, me, Matt, Max, and the drummer at the time. We realised that I could play drums better than he could, and I was a singer, so I was like, right, that's not going to work.
Matt like lives two doors down from me, so one day I got a knock on the door just being like, oh, do you want to play in a band? And that's all I wanted to do at the time, so I just said yes.
I knew him from back in the day when we were trading Pokemon cards, and I was like playing in my front garden and he'd walk past, and I just think he was the weird kid from two doors down.
First time I met Chris, I was like, first thing that I said to everyone now is, wow, this guy is quiet.
You could tell when he joined the band, he was just like, he didn't know what to think of it, he just wanted to play guitar and just rock it out and just... He comes from like a bit of a musical background. And I saw like the same resemblance in Matt and Chris together. They were like kind of the same. So it's like me and Josh were kind of the same, and Chris and Matt were kind of the same. It kind of worked and we all got along. To promotions websites on MySpace because it was such a popular thing at that time, saying, oh, book our band to play a show here, here and here. And we kind of made like a 7 to 12 day tour out of it with another band called Def Can Dance.
I can't even remember who mentioned it, but somebody was like, oh, there's this thing called the Megabus, where it takes you to the country anywhere for a pound. And we were like, well, what could be so bad about that? You know, it's a, I mean, obviously it's pretty cheap, it's going to be a bit dodgy, but it'll be all right.
Travelling on public transport when touring is a bit of a weird one, because it was like so open for us. It was like, this is the first tour we're ever going to go on. We were just so excited to get out almost. It was like, it was a real experience, like to be like, now we've got to fend for ourselves. We don't have our parents here in these places like Bristol and Newport.
Trying to carry like a backpack full of clothes with two guitars and then like a guitar head under your arm.
Hi-hat, snare, sticks, whatever.
People were just looking at us and going, what?
We walked over to this bus and the guy was like, you're not bringing that on my bus. And I was like, and our parents had just left, so there's no like growing up to like argue. And I was just like, well, yeah, we are, because we bought the tickets. Look, here's our confirmation sheet. It's like, where are you gonna put it? I was like, we'll put it on our laps. He's like, you're gonna put this equipment on your laps for a 2.5 hour journey. I was like, yeah, no big deal. So off we went.
Stands out to me playing shows-wise on that first tour we ever did was we played in Newport. We played at the venue called TJ's. It looked kind of deserted, a bit rough.
I remember that night we couldn't afford anywhere to stay. We literally had nowhere to stay. Only two people came to the show because we'd stay at the show. So we'd be like, oh, is there anywhere we can stay tonight? Anyone can put us up. But obviously, if there's two people at the show and those two people can't put you up, what are you going to do?
The show ended and the promoters turned around and said, oh, you can sleep upstairs in the flat upstairs. I'm like, oh, result, brilliant, okay, cool, let's do that.
The guy took us upstairs and he opened the door, he just pushed the door open and it wasn't locked or anything, and we're like, whoa, like, this is a real rough area, just somebody could push a door open like that, what's going to happen, we're staying here tonight.
It looked like a crack den.
There's one TV channel and it's the CCTV from outside, where you can see, like, all these crackheads and stuff walking up and down.
So we closed the door after and I'm like, right, get chairs, get tables, get everything you can. Let's, you know, barricade this shit up.
So he pushed like this sofa up against the door. We're all like cuddled up on the floor, just going, ooh, this is sweet, we're touring. Oh yeah, awesome.
We're watching fights happen outside in the street, people arguing in the bar, people getting pissed, people making out with each other.
I don't think we told our parents about that one.
I think in general, like the whole concept of that tour, when I mean, I was 15, everyone else was 16, I think it was just kind of unheard of. Like trying to book us different stuff, and I managed to get us on this festival called Slam Dunk. I had like Real Big Fish and Paramore and stuff, and I was super stoked. And I was like, right, all right, boys, you know, make sure everyone's got their shit together for when we leave on Sunday. And we rolled up, and the one thing that we were told our drummer at the time to do was, you know, get the CDs ready, make sure we had enough sticks, skins, whatever. And we turned up, and he was like, oh, I just need to go pick up some sticks. And we're like, well, what have you been doing all week? You know, this is the biggest show you've ever done. And it sounds kind of trivial, but at the time we were like, if this is how it's going to be for the biggest thing that's going on in our band right now, what if we ever progressed and it got more serious? And I think, you know, we just kind of felt that that wasn't really a risk we were willing to take.
And I literally had to like deliver the final blow, and it was like the most awkward thing ever, and he just kind of just kind of got up and left, basically, and that was that.
Go home and get some sleep.
I got dinner.
Thank you. You guys go eat.
Good work, sir. Lean back. Back posture.
Yes, you know I've got the pummeling claw.
Up a little bit in your left hand.
Yes, I love
that. When we were getting a new drummer, I remember we were talking about it, and I was like, oh, I know this guy Dan in my class. And they were like, is he any good? I was like, oh, I think he's all right. Like, he seems to do well when we're playing covers at college. And they're like, oh, well, give him a go.
And then he randomly one day phoned me up and was like, oh, we're having some problems with our drummer. Do you want to come down and play with us? We've got a couple of shows coming up, kind of thing. So I was like, yeah, sounds like fun.
Everyone else had really sussed Dan out because they'd been at college with him. And I remember coming to band practice the first time, I'd never met him, and the guys, like, at the time was going to be our session drummer, because we thought we were all
important, and you know, that's how we should label him, as a session drummer. And I walked into the room, I was like, I thought for a second it was like some chav that worked at the studios. I was like, who is this kid? And then he started playing drums, and I was like, wow, this guy can play drums.
And he just wanted it. He was like, he was into it.
We just kind of locked in really, really quickly, and the vibe was just literally there. And after one practice, we're vibing.
Show at the Underworld was definitely a turning point for the band. You could tell we were all there backstage, we were psyched up for it, but we could also tell we were really nervous as well.
The thing about this Underworld show is we'd practiced with Dan maybe twice with Josh and once without him. So this poor guy, we were just like, oh, this show's big time, like, we've got these agents coming down, we've got labels coming down, we've got management coming down. And Dan was going,
we've only practiced three times. I was like, yeah, just taking the vibe. He was like, I've like never played a gig before.
Yeah, he was fucking bricking it.
Yeah, I was quite nervous because it was quite a big show for the guys. They were still in the middle of sort of getting rid of the other drummer, and I was coming in and playing these shows, so it was all kind of up in the air. And I think it was very last minute, just like, do you want to play this show? We need you to do it, kind of thing. And I was like, yeah, fine, I'll do it.
And it was so weird. For me, it was the first time I didn't feel like I had to look behind me. Like, I felt like everybody knew what they were doing, and we all wanted the same thing, and it just worked.
It felt like this was You, Me at Six.
Been touring for a while, just like different bands and doing our own kind of thing, and then I guess we all sat down and thought, let's do an album, you know, get something out there for people to actually buy and, you know, get us to that next level.
I just wanted to sound like my favorite bands, which I think when you're starting off as a musician, that's all you want to do. You want to emulate what, you know, people that you admire have done, and that's all I really aimed for.
Yeah, that was literally blasted out 2 weeks around Outhouse Studios with our friends John Mitchell and Matt O'Grady. And it was, looking back on it now, I don't think it's a very good CD at all, or like, we're nowhere near where we are now, and like, even just sonically, it doesn't sound anywhere near as good. But I think it really, the sound of that CD really captured where we were at that point.
Take Off Your Colours was everything we needed it to be for that moment in time. It didn't need to be anything more, anything less, it needed to be that. If you stand that album up against Hold Me Down.